Your parents' religion is a more important factor for determining your religious identity than almost any other factor, including race, socioeconomic status, or education. The Sufi theologian and mystic al-Ghazali even noticed this 1,000 years ago. "I saw that Christian youths always grew up to be Christians, Jewish youths to be Jews, and Muslim youths to be Muslims." Modern surveys seem to corroborate this too. For example, Pew Research found that 80% of kids raised by two Protestant parents identify as Protestants in adulthood. So why do kids always seem to follow the same religion as their parents? Transmitting religious identity from parent to kid has long been studied within the sociology of religion, but it's not so simple. When you look around, it's also pretty obvious that many people don't share the same religion as their parents, or maybe have become very critical of their own upbringings. Why the difference? One possible answer is the theory creds. Credibility-enhancing displays. The basic idea that we are more likely to adopt the beliefs of those around us who practice what they preach. But we first need to take a step back and consider the larger evolutionary context of how and why we learn from others. Imagine being transported to a foreign country surrounded by plants and animals you've never seen before. You need to find food soon, but you have no idea what plants are edible. So ask around. Some people say eat the fruit, some people say eat the mushrooms, but you notice that the mushroom recommenders aren't actually eating the mushrooms themselves. Okay, that's suspicious. And moreover, the fruit eaters look healthier. So you have three options: eat the fruit, eat the mushrooms, or try your own strategy and possibly get poisoned in the process. The choice is obvious. Listen to the fruit people because number one, they appear more successful, and number two, they're actually practicing what they preach. This example, adapted from an article written by the psychology professor Will Gervais and his co-authors, demonstrates how social context influences our own learning. Humans, perhaps more so than any other animal, rely on information gathered from others in order to survive. Of course, any social environment we belong to is full of way too much information for any one person to process. So we use simple rules of thumb in order to sort through important information. These rules of thumb include the conformist bias, which means we are biased towards the beliefs of the majority. Another is the prestige bias, meaning that we preferentially pay attention to those who we culturally view as prestigious due to success, skill, age, or sex. And finally, we look for consistencies between what someone tells us and their actions. In the previous example, someone telling you to eat mushrooms while never eating them themselves automatically throws up a red flag, making us suspect they're manipulating us. On the other hand, someone who tells us that eating fruit is safe while actually eating fruit themselves seems more trustworthy. This is an example of what researchers in the evolutionary study of culture call a credibility-enhancing display, and it has inspired one of the most important contemporary frameworks for studying the transmission of religious belief. Creds are one way of solving what is known as the Zeus problem in evolutionary theories of religion. Why place faith in some gods but not others, such as the gods of neighboring cultures? If we share the idea of Zeus with the ancient Greeks, why did they conduct costly rituals in his name while most today don't? Why worship Baal instead of Thor, or Thor instead of the Christian God? What the theory of creds proposes is that we are products of our cultural learning environments. When important figures in our life tell us that an unseen force is real, and they walk the walk by conducting rituals and obeying the moral codes ordained by that being, our natural tendency is to follow suit. Creds are thought to be important for sustaining beliefs in the power of religious forces which are otherwise unseen, unknowable, or mysterious to our everyday working cognition. Santa Claus is a great example, and bear with me. Many American children undergo a pretty startling evolution of belief about Santa Claus over the course of their lives. When they first learn about him, he functions for them in the role of a standard moral god. He observes and he records human behaviors in order to reward the good and punish the bad. The environment of early childhood is well structured to acquire this belief, as both the majority of peers believe in Santa and it's reinforced by high prestige figures, your parents. Moreover, parents who might otherwise come under suspicion from a perceptive child perform a variety of creds to reinforce this belief for their kids, setting out cookies, providing presents from Santa, telling stories, and singing songs about him. This is all something we might expect to see for any standard religious belief. But then as children age, they receive less and less support in their environment for belief in Santa's power. their peers may slowly begin to disbelieve. They may catch their parents in the act, or their parents may directly tell them that he doesn't exist. As a result, past a certain age, none of the children still believe that Santa is a real being. This is the power of social environments and creds for shaping our individual religious beliefs. Over a relatively short period of time, our view of a supernatural god who should be feared can transition to a cute folktale based on the cues we receive from others in our social group. Now, of course, most religious beliefs taught to children by their parents are expected to be held over their entire lifetime, unlike belief in Santa. But even here, creds play a critical role in determining whether or not kids will still follow them as adults. A quantitative study on Americans found that individuals who were exposed to high level of religious creds by their caregivers were especially likely to report currently believing in the existence of God with high certainty. And the opposite was true as well, with low exposure to creds leading to less belief in God with equally high certainty. Research into the role of creds in shaping religious identity is just beginning, so there are a number of open questions about religious identity that we have yet to answer. For example, several researchers have argued that we should shift our attention to credibility undermining displays, or hypocritical behavior by religious authorities as the key factor in explaining why people abandon their previous religious affiliations. Also, too little is known about how a whole bunch of factors, such as education and psychology, might influence the tendency of individuals to accept religious creds in the first place. Nevertheless, it seems to be becoming clear that if you want to convince someone of something incredible, you had better be a credible source yourself. As always, thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.